Welcome to the next session of Programming for Problem Solving. The topic for the day is Fundamentals of Programming in C. So now you are already aware of what is an algorithm and what is a flowchart. It is the right time to move from algorithm to program. C character set. Now what is a C character set? Character set refers to all legal characters that are allowed in C programming language construct. That means whatever legally you can write in a C program, that all is known as a character set of C. So what all are included in the character set of C? Letters. Letters include all the alphabets starting from small a to z, capital A to z. That means both in uppercase and lowercase, you can use the alphabets A to z. Next comes your digits. That is all the digits or 0 to 9 or the combination of digits to form larger numbers like 190, 120 and so on. White spaces. These refers to the blank area of spaces, that is blank spaces that are used to divide the words or token in a C program. So what are white spaces? Basically creating the division between two different elements of a C program. For example, if you write A is equals to B plus C or anything that divides the two components within a single program is known as a blank space. The last one is called the special characters. Other than the alphabets, digits, white spaces, C allows you to use special characters that have certain predefined meanings. A list of all such symbols has been given right at the bottom. All these symbols have a predefined meaning. So whenever you use this, any of these symbols, you have to use it according to the predefined syntax format given by the C programming language. Tokens. The tokens are so important that everything you write inside a C program is identified as a token. In a short, you can say that everything in a C program is a token. So let's have a look at the formal definition of a token. A token is the smallest element or unit in a C program. But it does not mean that you write anything, it will be considered as a token. A token which is understood by the compiler, which has a predefined or a new understood meaning, a user-defined data type or anything which has a legal meaning is called a token. Something that cannot be identified by the compiler is not a token and an error will be generated. Another important point. The very first step of a compiler is to identify the different tokens. And the process of identifying the different tokens in a C program is called a lexical analysis. So lexical analysis is performed to identify the different tokens that are available in the C program. And in case the compiler fails to identify any legal token, then it will produce an error. So you can divide a set of tokens by using a white space, a blank space basically, a horizontal or a vertical tab, or new lines or commands. Following is the list of some of the tokens or the different categories of tokens that we will study in the next coming slides. They are identifiers, keywords, literals, operators, and punctuators. So we will start with what are identifiers. Identifiers are names assigned to any user-defined object or a variable. So within a program, if you want to work on certain values, you need to save those values inside a variable. Now, if you're using two or three variables, then you should be able to identify the different variables. Then how can you identify different variables? For example, if I give you a program to find the sum of two numbers and save it in the third number, then you need to accept the input of two numbers. Obviously, you need to save them somewhere in the memory. and you should be able to identify which is the value of the first variable and which is the value of the second variable. And how you can do that? You can do that by giving the names to those variables which are known as identifiers. I repeat, identifiers are the names assigned to any user defined object. So are there any rules by which I can give the names to the variables? Yes. C programming provides you with a set of rules that must be strictly followed if you want to name any variable. What are those rules? The identifier name can only start with an alphabet or an underscore. So you can either start the name of the variable with an alphabet or an underscore. A name can consist of only the alphabets, underscores, and numeric digits. So other than these three categories, you cannot use any special symbol while naming an identifier. It can only start with an alphabet and an underscore. After that, it can also include the numerical digits, but it cannot include any special symbol other than the underscore. Name cannot include blank spaces, so do not give blank spaces. Depending upon the compiler, the size of the identifier is fixed. In most of the cases, it is fixed to 31 characters. Other than the identifiers, like the name of the variable that I am going to give, there are certain strings or certain names which are predefined and are used as keywords in the program, in a C program. They have a predefined meaning and their names are fixed. So you cannot use any of those names. So keywords, which are predefined words within a C program, they cannot be used to name an identifier. And the last one is that naming the identifier is case sensitive. If you name a variable with capital ABC, then you cannot access it with small ABC. Or in other words, you can say, you can create two variables, one with capital ABC and one with small ABC. So these are the six rules that you must follow while naming any identifier. So some of the legal names of an identifier are NAME. It starts with an alphabet and it only includes alphabet. OBJ1. It consists of only the alphabets and the numeric, and it starts with an alphabet. N_1, again, it includes a alphabet, underscore, and a digit. So hence all these are legal. So let's have a look at some of the illegal ones that you cannot use and the compiler will give you an error. The first one is one name. It only includes digits and alphabets, but it starts with a digit, which is not allowed. Here you have n.g. N and g are two alphabets, but dot symbol is not allowed. The only symbol allowed is underscore. int. This is perfectly looking like a legal name, int. The reason it is given as an invalid identifier because int is a keyword and has a predefined meaning in the C program. As already stated, you cannot give a name to an identifier which is already used as a keyword. So this is all about identifier and the different rules that you must follow while naming an identifier. Keywords. Keywords are the reserved words of any programming language that have some special predefined meaning, and following is a long list of keywords that are used in C programming language. Now, depending upon different compilers, the list can increase or decrease. These are the most commonly used keywords in any advanced compiler of C programming language. So, what is the meaning of these different keywords? That you will definitely see as and when you encounter these keywords while programming. The next is operators. The operators are discussed in a great detail in the upcoming video lecture, that is operators and expressions. But still, you should know what is an operator. An operator are special C symbols that are used to perform some operation in C. So what are the operators? Operators are symbols. Now these symbols also have a predefined meaning, and you cannot change the meaning or the attributes of that operator. As you can see here, C is equals to A plus B. How many types of operators or how many operators are there? Two operators are here. One is this arithmetic operator plus, which is used to add the content of A and B. And the other operator used here is equal to, which is an assignment operator. So what will happen? This operator will assign the value or the result of A plus B into C. So similarly to this, these two, there are a number of operators that have been discussed in great detail in the next video. So for now, you should just understand that other than identifier keywords, operators are the third type of tokens that are identified within a program by the lexical analysis. Literals or symbolic constants. Literals or constants are the constant values that are used within a program. Some of the examples of the literals or constants are string literals. String is a collection of characters. A character is any alphabet or a digit. And a string constant is given inside the double quotes. For example, A, B, H, I, given inside the double quote means that this is a string constant or a string literal. How do I come to know that is a string literal? I repeat, because it is given inside the double quotes. It is called a literal or a constant because the value is fixed. Next is an integer constant. An integer constant can be any whole number like 20, 30, 22, 25. Any number given like this is called an integer constant. Or any float literal is a number with decimal value. And it can be given like 23.8, 50.5. Such constants are called float constants. The last one is known as character constant. As you can see on the top, I am highlighting it again. This is the sequence of characters. It is not a single character, but a sequence of characters given inside the double quotes. That is why it is called a string literal. When you give a single character, which is enclosed inside the single quote, it is called the character. This is the difference between a string constant and a character. Other than this, there is a list of escape sequence that you will use in a program and have been explained in detail in the next video. These are also known as character constants. Some of the examples of the character constants are slash A, slash B, slash N, slash R, E, and so on. All these character constants, which are known as escape sequences, start with slash. All these have a predefined meaning. For example, slash A is known as for alert. It displays or not displays, but it produces a sound called a bell sound. Slash B is for backspace. Slash N is for new line. Slash R is for carriage return, simply like this. So these are the four types of constants that you can use in your C program. Next are symbolic constants. Other than the constant itself, you can also create symbolic constants, which are the names that can be given to any constant value. So whenever you use those names within the program, they are replaced with those values. What is a symbolic constant? A symbolic constant is a name that substitutes for a sequence of characters that cannot be changed. How can you create the symbolic constant? Symbolic constants in a C program can be created using the hash defined precursor. Please have a look at the example I am currently highlighting. It says hash define number 15. So what does this do? It creates a symbolic constant num for the value 15. So 15 is a constant, but rather than using this constant in a program, we are creating a symbolic constant for it. Now, when you write a program in C, wherever you will use num inside the program. For example, if you assign A is equals to num, B is equals to num, then you will compile this program. The pre-processing will replace num with 15 wherever you have used it. So if in your program you say A is equals to num, when you pre-compile it, A is equals to num will be converted by A is equals to 15. It is very useful in cases when you want to use this symbolic constant values multiple times. For example, let's say 100 times. And if you want to change the value of that symbolic constant, then you have to replace it 100 times. Rather than using that concept, if you define a symbolic constant on the top, then if you want to change the value of that constant, you just need to make one change in the symbolic constant and it will be done at all the 100 places. This is called a symbolic constant. Next token is called punctuators. Punctuators are also known as separators and they are basically used to indicate the start or end of something. Some authors also call punctuators as operators, but they do not perform any kind of processing. They can be considered as operators, but generally the operators are used to perform some task, whereas punctuators are not going to perform any operation. They are only used to indicate the start or end of something. Like comma operator, you can declare two variables using the comma operator, separate them using a comma operator. Semicolon is used to indicate the end of the statement. Colon is often used to separate two parts. And then you have parentheses that are of three types. Round bracket is, round parentheses are used for function. Square brackets are used for arrays. And the curly braces are used to indicate the different blocks. So please keep in mind that punctuators may be considered as operators, but these are the separators which do not perform any operation and are only used to indicate the end or division of something. Now come to the important topic, that is data types. If you want to store some information in a C program, it is important to assign the type to that value that you want to store. It is easy then to apply the different operation on those data types. Broadly, we categorize all data types into three types. One are known as inbuilt, which are already available, predefined in the C compiler. The other one is called the user-defined, the ones that you can create as a programmer if you need it in a program. And the third category is called derived data type. Derived means you can derive them from the inbuilt or the user-defined data type. So let's have a look at these data types one by one. This is a long table which gives you an insight into various inbuilt data types. Broadly, we have only four types of data types as you go back. Four inbuilt data types. One is integer, character, float, and double. Void is rarely used. So let's go to the next slide again. So initially what we have is an integer. And integer takes 2 bytes of in the memory and its value ranges from -3 to 768 to 3 to 767. So how many bits are used? 16 bits are used. Now what do you mean by sign? Sign means the value can both be positive or negative. So if you have 16 bits, one bit will be used for representing the sign, that is plus or minus. So that means you are left with only 15 bits to represent the value. Next is unsigned integer. Unsigned means the value is always positive. There will be no sign. the value will always be positive. And it also takes 2 bytes in the memory, which means that all the 16 bytes are available to store the value. That is why its upper range is double than the range of the signed integer, because signed integer has 1 bit less to represent the value. What if you want to compute what is the maximum value it can have? It is 2 power 16 for the unsigned and 2 power 15 for the signed. So there are special names that are used, special specifiers that have been used with it are called short and signed. Signed and unsigned basically means whether the value will be positive, negative, or only positive. Short. Now, some compilers differentiate between the simple integer and a short integer, and some do not. So, in brief, a short integer is one which may be same as a normal integer in some compilers, or it takes only 1 byte in the memory. Now, if a short integer takes 1 byte in the memory, then its maximum unsigned range can be 256. That is 2 power 8. So why we use a short integer? If the value for which we are creating a variable cannot be larger than 256, then it is only beneficial to use the short. So I hope you are able to understand what is integer. An integer is used to store the whole numbers within range of -3 to 768 to 3 to 767. If you want to save the memory and only 1 byte of memory is needed, then you can use the short integer and it will take only 1 byte in memory. Unsigned means only the positive values will be saved. Next you have is a long int. Now what is a long int? Long int is one which takes 4 bytes in memory. Why you want to create a long byte? Because the variable that you are creating requires that you give more memory so that it can store larger values. So how do you decide you need a short int, a normal int, or a long int? The only criteria is the maximum range to which the value can go. If the value required is very large, or the value expected is very large, then use the long. For the middle range, use the normal int, and for the a very small range, use the short. If the value can both be positive and negative, then please use signed. And if the value will always be positive, then use unsigned. Next is character. Characters are used to store the alphabets, integers, or special symbols in the form of ASCII values. So for how many characters we have? A total of 256 characters that are allowed in the ASCII code. And every character is assigned a numeric value, which is known as the ASCII. So if you say A, B, C, D, these all are the characters which have a ASCII code. So if you want to use a character, then the amount of memory that it will take is 1 byte, that is 8. A float. It is also used to store the numeric values, but it is different from integer because integers are used to store only the whole numbers, whereas floats can be used to represent the or store the numeric values with decimal. So how much memory does it take? 4, and its range has also been given in the last column. If you want to store a decimal number which has a higher range than this, then you can use the double, which takes 8 bytes in memory, and if you need to save a number even beyond this range, then you can use the long double. So this is the brief description about the various data types, inbuilt data types that are available in the C program. Void. Void basically means nothing. A void data type means no data type. So why you want to create a variable that has no data type? Under normal circumstances, you do not create a normal variable of void data type because it is meaningless. So a void data type is used in two scenarios. One, when you want to create a pointer. A pointer is only used to save the address, and sometimes you can use the void data type to create a generic pointer which belongs to no data type. So it is just a pointer, but it has no data type. And void is also used when creating or defining functions. Void can be used as a return type. Now, what does that mean? The function will not return anything. So you can write simply void. So I repeat, void means no data type, and it is only used when you are creating the pointers, or it is used when you are defining the return type of a function. Derived data type. There are three types of data types that are named as derived. Some may argue that function is not a derived data type, but still I consider it to be a derived data type, and we will discuss in this slide. First derived data type is array. Array is a collection of similar or homogeneous data elements that belong to the same data type. Like we discussed, integer, short integer, long integer, float, character. But we can create a variable of these data types that can store only the atomic value. Atomic value means only a single value. If I say A is a variable of integer data type, then A is equals to 10. I can change the value of A is equals to 20. But it cannot hold onto two values, 10 and 20 at the same time. But if I want to create a variable that can hold onto multiple values, then I can use an array. An array can be used to hold onto multiple values at the same time, or we can create a collection. For example, roll number. If I create a normal variable, then I can hold the value of a roll number of single student. But if I create an array of roll number, then I can save the value of the roll number of all students in the class. Function. Function is a collection or a block of group of statements. So you can write a set of statements that are used to perform a specific task, and then you can group those tasks and put them inside a function. For example, swapping two numbers. So whatever code is required to swap two numbers, that can be put together inside a function, and you can name that function as swap. The last one is a pointer. Pointer is also a variable, but it does not save the value. Instead, it is used to save the address of already existing variables, or you can also create new memory. For example, you create a normal variable or a array variable, array like integer A. A is a normal variable, or you can create an array. So they can also hold on to values. When they hold on to some value, they must be assigned some memory. So when they are assigned some memory, there will be an address associated with that. Now a pointer variable basically can be used to save that address. Pointers have also been discussed in great detail in the coming videos. The next type of data types are called user-defined data types. These are the data types that you can create. A structure is a collection of heterogeneous data elements. So like an array. A structure is similar to an array, but an array is a collection of single type of elements, whereas a structure is an element of heterogeneous data elements. Structure is basically used to record or store the values belonging to different objects like student. Now a student can have multiple information associated with it, like name, age, roll number, gender, contact number, father name, class, so much of information. And all this information is of different data type. So there, all information can be grouped together into a single structure or a single unit. Similarly, like an employee, what is the ID of the employee, name of the employee, father of the employee, department of the employee, salary, all these can be grouped together into a single structure called employee. Union. Union is similar to the structure, hence it is also a collection of heterogeneous data elements, but the only difference is that all the members are mutually exclusive of each other. That means only one value is active at one time. If you have five elements, then based upon some condition, you know that only one value is required at one time. Sometimes like searching. Searching can be based upon the roll number, name or father name or contact number. So you can store only one value, either the roll number, either the contact number. So there is no need to have an access to all elements. So structure and union are same, only except the difference is that structure is a collection of heterogeneous elements and all elements can be active at one time. And in union, only one element is active at a time. NM stands for enumerated data type. Members of NM data type defines or describes constants and written as identifiers that can have signed integer values. For example, you can create an enumerated data type color and you can give fixed values, constant values to the color. For example, if you create an enumerated data type color, you can give three values to it: red, green, and blue. Now a user can only assign red, green, or blue value to any variable of NM data type. If it tries to give a color other than red, green, or blue, it will give an error. So it basically creates variables with the fixed constant value. You cannot go beyond that fixed values. Type specifiers and quantifiers. You have already seen what are type specifiers. Short basically used to create data types with that require lesser space. For example, integer takes 2 bytes, a short integer may take 1 byte. What impact it has, it reduces the range. Long means you want to save values with the higher range and it requires more memory. Signed means both positive and negative values are there, and unsigned means only the positive. Now we will try to understand what are type quantifiers. There are two types of quantifiers that we can use while we declare the variable. One is called const. Const stands for constant. When we declare any variable of any data type as const, once the value is assigned to it, that value cannot change. For example, integer a is equals to 10. The value of a is 10. And you can change the value of a anytime in the program. But if you create a const int a is equals to 10, that means a is a constant whose value is 10, and that value cannot be changed anytime during the program. What is volatile? Volatile means creating some data element whose value can be changed either in the program itself, or it can be changed by some external source like an interrupt or any other source. So that type of a variable which is declared using the volatile type quantifier means that its value can be changed by some external source. Now a volatile can also be declared as a const. Now what is the impact of creating a volatile const element? It means that its value cannot be changed during the program or inside a program, but its value can be changed by some external source. Variables. Like a const explained in the last slide, a const is one whose value cannot change. Contrary to that, a normal variable is one whose value can vary within a. So how to create a normal variable? Int a is a normal variable and const int a is a constant. A variable is one whose value can be changed or its value can vary, and const whose value cannot vary. Errors in C. While we write the programs in C, how many types of errors can be faced within a program have been listed below. Syntax error, runtime error, linker error, logical error, and semantic error. Now we will have a look at these errors one by one. The first one is called a syntax error. The syntax error occurs when you violate the rule of C++ syntax construct. So every programming language, including C, gives you a set of rules that you must follow while writing the syntax. If you look at the sample program given below, this syntax might not be clear to you at this point of time, but still I would like to explain what is the error in this. Every statement within a C program ends with a semicolon. So there should be a semicolon right here, like this. This statement in the program should have been something like this, a semicolon at the end of the statement. Because the semicolon was not given, an error has been given by the compiler that says expected this before the. So this is called a syntax error. And why this syntax error has been generated? Because we violated the C++ syntax construct is also known as the rules. The next type of error is a runtime error. So this means that there is no compiler error. You have not made any mistake in your program. You have written the program well, and the program is also successfully running. But due to some, unforeseen circumstances, an error has been generated. Some value has been given to the user, which has resulted into an error. This kind of errors occur during the execution of the program. Let's have a look at the program very carefully. In this program, we have created one variable x whose value is 52. There is no problem. Y is equals to 0. There is no problem. These two values can also be accepted as input from the user. So that means user says the value of x is 52 and y is. Now the third line produces the or tries to print the division of x by y. Now it is wrong. You cannot divide any number with zero. If you try to do that, the program is obviously going to produce an error. Now this type of error can only be identified at the runtime when the program is running. The next is linker error. This is very important. You understand what is a linker error. Generally, when you write a program, you write a set of statements that may require the inbuilt library functions, some functions that are inbuilt and you can directly use them. For example, clearing the screen, accepting the input from the user, displaying the output to the user, computing some mathematical functions or applying some mathematical functions. Now what happens is this kind of error occurs when the program has been successfully compiled at the first stage. That means this object file has been made and we are trying to link the different object files that have been called in this program. Now due to some error within those files or wrong method of calling those or linking those files, a linker error can be generated. So why a linker error has come? Because we could not link to the object files that are required by our source code. Logical error. Logical error basically means some kind of programming logic has gone wrong. You have done some mistake. It is not a syntax mistake, it is not a runtime mistake, but you have written a logic wrong. It is impossible for the compiler or anything supported by the compiler to find the logical errors. So how you can find the logical errors? You have to debug the program step by step and then check why the program is not giving the correct output. As you can see in this program, there is one logical error, as you can see in this statement. This is a control statement and it is not a normal statement. In a normal statement, all statements end with a semicolon, but a control statement never ends with a semicolon. But it is a logical error because it is allowed. You can write a control statement with a semicolon, but logically you should not do that. So here is the logical error. Plus, in this it is written that I is equals to 0, I less than 5, I plus plus. Now instead of I plus plus, if you by mistake write I minus minus. So it is also a logical error. You made a logical error. And it is impossible for the compiler to find such logical errors. So you have to debug these programs one at a time, line by line, to find what type of error has been committed. The last type of error is called the semantic error. These semantic errors are basically occurring because you did not follow the rules of the grammar, the way you should write the statement. Are they similar to the syntax error? The answer is somewhat no. But they come under the category of syntax, but the syntax is correct. Maybe the placing is not correct. So what does that mean? I will give you an example and it will be easy for you to understand what is a semantic error. For example, if I write A is equal to B plus C. Now, A, which is on the left-hand side of the assignment operator, equal to, is called the L value. And B plus C, which is on the right-hand side of the assignment, is known as R value. And this is perfectly legal as well. A is equals to B plus C, which means I want to assign the sum of B plus C to A. Now, what if I write it like this, B plus C is equals to A? There is nothing wrong in B plus C, there is nothing wrong in equal to, but there is nothing wrong in A. But B plus C cannot be written on the left side of the assignment operator. This violates the grammar rules of how to write the arithmetic expressions in the C program. I repeat, it violates the grammar rules for writing the arithmetic expressions in the C programming language. As you can see in this program carefully, it should have been Z is equals to X plus Y. Instead, it has been written as X plus Y is equals to Z. This is a special category of error, syntax error, which is known as semantic. Syntax error means basically you are writing something wrong. And in semantic error, you are placing a component or an element at a wrong position. So I hope all these types of errors are clear to you. In this lecture, what we saw was what are the different character sets that you can, different characters that you can use in a C program. What is a token, that smallest element or a smallest unit in a program? How many types of tokens are there? The different data types. The data types means the types of values that you can use in a C program. What are the different types of quantifiers or specifiers that can be assigned with the data type? And in the end, we see the different types of errors that can come while you write a C program. I hope this topic is clear to you and you were able to understand these basic terms in a C program. And we will see how we can apply different operators to these concepts that you have studied. What are the different expressions and how you can write a simple C program in the next video lecture. Till then,